girl.
You don't have to stand on this. This is for me.
I'm going to stand on your shoulders.
Okay. So, hey, everyone. Just wanted to thank everyone for coming out. It's a wonderful turnout. Wanted to thank our sponsors, Jubilee Baltimore, Vermont Arts District, Station North Arts District, the Merchants Association, BOPA, and especially want to thank Michael and Julianne Current Gallery for for sponsor, everyone else for partnering with this event and being a great neighbor and partner in this neighborhood. So we are celebrating a few things tonight. First, we are celebrating the 101st birthday of our first building at 406 North Howard Street, which some of you, maybe all of you, have seen. If not, we'll give one more tour after Bert's talk. And wanted to point this out. It was built in March 16th, 1916, as the Strand Theater, which back then was a small theater, considered a small theater at 500 seats. And because it was small, it struggled and changed hands a few times and finally closed in 1923 and was separated into two buildings. As you'll see in the space, we've opened it up as one large arts and cultural destination for the first time since it closed its doors in 1923. So we're very excited about that and about, we're designating today as our especially because of the symbolic date, as our official soft opening. So we're celebrating it being born and it being 101 at the same time, which you don't see every day. This is a wonderful birthday gift that we received from Amy Davis, a photographer at The Sun. She found this ticket in the, what was the theater, The Mechanic. She found this in The Mechanic. This is a ticket from The Strand from March 12th, 1917. So this is a really appreciate this gift from Amy at The Sun of this ticket of The Strand. So we're celebrating that. We're also celebrating the fact this is the end of our, today's the end of our fundraiser campaign. We've raised, is it Carly or someone? Carly. You know?
43, 45?
No more than that. Was a couple days ago. I think it was around 47, 48,000. But that number continues to go up because we're going to add the donations that we receive for today's dinner to that as well. So it's really going to help us finish the building because right now we still have more construction to do. We're going to put in sprinklers in the building to get it up to a 350 capacity venue. So we're celebrating the fact that we're at the end of our fundraiser. And we're also just celebrating the fact that we're here. We're here at downtown Baltimore in the Bromar Arts District on the Howard Street corridor in two artist-owned buildings with the DCAC on the corner, another artist-owned building on the corner, with other two other artist-owned venues down the street on Mulberry with Platform and with Michael and Ryan's building, and with in the midst of so many other stable and sustainable art venues like MAP, 14 Carat, so many of the galleries on Franklin Street. So
that was part of my routine.
And all it's not going to be the last time that I steal some of your script, Bert. So we're just celebrating the fact that we're in this arts district that we're trying, has the opportunity to be an unprecedented move here in Baltimore where we take an arts district and really install a lot of artist equity instead of the artists, as it often goes, being put in at first and then having a hard time stabilizing themselves as the development that follows profits off of the pioneering that has been done. So this is just it's just amazing to be here today to celebrate just that concept of an artist-driven arts venue, artist-driven arts district, which seems like it's common sense, but it's not the way it always goes. With artists with equity in the district, and there's no one better to talk about this than my friend and mentor Bert Crenca. I worked at AS220, the space that it's more than a space, I can't call it a space, the arts organization is in Providence, Rhode Island. I worked there with Bert for 3 years, and I learned a lot from that model, and we're doing our best to apply that to this these buildings across the street at LeMondo. And no one better to symbolically cut this ribbon for opening these spaces and bring more attention to the fact that this is both an unprecedented and a precedented endeavor. So Bert's going to talk a little bit, and then go for some dinner across the street. We could all talk to Bert, and why don't you break the ice?
Okay. All right, I didn't really prepare a talk for this evening because I'm doing an extensive talk tomorrow. How many people are going to be able to attend the talk tomorrow? So there are a few people who will not be there, so we'll cover a little bit. My name is Bert Crenca, Umberto, actually, a first-generation American. My father was born in Italy. I come from very humble roots. Both my parents, my mother was a second-generation Portuguese from the Azores, and they worked in factories their entire life. I was not exposed to development. I was exposed to very, very, very little art. My father would sing a couple of lines from a couple of Italian operas badly over and over and over again, and that was my cultural enrichment, other than the fact that my father told me a lot of stories, having been a merchant marine, about places all over the world, and gave me a really kind of broad sense of the world and the variety of people that exist in it, which has always been a blessing to me. There's a few things I want to say. I started an arts organization. You'll hear a lot about this tomorrow, so I'm not going to belabor this part of it. With $800 in what was a boarded up city. That's not an exaggeration. Doreen can give testimony to that fact, I think. There's a few things I want to say about this place that are just very quick observations down and dirty. Now, I have been to Baltimore a few times. I know when the Deutsch Foundation was talking about their buildings down in Station North, they came to Providence and talked to me, and they brought me here a couple of times and was trying to give as much advice from my experience as possible. We have another gentleman here who has also visited us in Providence a while back. But let me make a couple of quick observations, and then I would love to entertain a little bit of conversation if we have time.
Yeah.
If that's possible, okay? So I'd rather provoke a dialogue than a monologue. Le Mondo, Psychic Readings, EMP, Everyman, Current Gallery, H&H Studios, DCAC, Bromo Arts District, Platform Gallery, MAP, 14 Karat Cabaret, Lexington Market, Hippodrome, all within a 7-block, 2-block area. You have a cultural district. And you have people that live here. I'm not sure if I'm seeing a whole lot of those people in this room. Just saying. I might be wrong. I'm just saying, right? There's an inevitability. And I'm leaving town in 2 days, so whether this is true or not doesn't matter, right? But there's an inevitability about what's happening here, what's going to happen here, okay? You have assets here. You know the difference between a kind of negative asset approach. You know, you look at all the pregnancy rates and unemployment and this stuff and all that crap, and then you build some sort of a program to respond to those situations. That's important. But there's the ABCD approach, asset-based community development. It's an old school model. It's in a model that can apply here. But it takes a lot of collaboration. It takes collaboration from your business organization, from your neighborhood organizations, from your arts community, from your cultural institutions. You have to create the forum for people to come together to be able to both protect and help advance those businesses that are here, you know, and the community of residents are here. And I'm dogged about this. It's incredibly, incredibly hard work. But I'm going to tell you, I have had the privilege, the absolute privilege, to be in a lot of different communities that are thinking about reinventing their downtowns. Because what happened, and some of this I'll probably talk about again tomorrow too, what happened in the 50s, you all know the Robert Moses and, what's her name?
Jane Jacobs
battle in New York City. Well, there's a lot in that dialogue. Okay, that we all can continue to learn from. And what would the Robert Moses approach is similar to us building our highways in the 50s under Eisenhower, the move outside of cities into the malls, and the kind of abandonment by a lot of people of our downtowns and urban cores, because we were promised utopia with our ranch house and our yard, and we remember those pictures of the housewives pointing to their toast oven, not a microwave, too soon for that. We were really getting excited about color television, I think, around the same time, too, if I remember correctly. I'm 66 years old, so I actually do have some remembrances of this. And the whole industry in our section, the Rust Belt, is Baltimore considered part of the Rust Belt?
Yeah. Yes.
We have disagreement here, yes. But we know industry and all these things moved out. We built highways, cut off the poorer neighborhoods from our downtowns with the highways. And this promise of utopia. Well, all those people who thought they were buying into utopia, the next generation say, this sucks. I don't want to shop at a mall, and I don't want to live in isolation. I want community, right? And they want to move back into the cities. Well, guess what? There are people here that didn't leave, and there's generations of people that are here. So in my opinion, that needs to be a negotiation. We'd love to have you back. We really would. Because in 1950, you were a community of 1 million people, and now you're a community of 650,000 people. You built an infrastructure and a government that can be supported by a tax base of 1 million people, but you have a tax base of 650,000, and that's and with probably a high unemployment rate, I'm assuming, in Baltimore, right? So you need those people back, right? You need to build that tax base. You need to be able to have people going to all the restaurants and the hip and cool shit that's happening and beginning to develop, you know? But I think that's a negotiation. And I think it's up to the community and the residents of this community and the variety of organizations, including the cultural organizations, including the individual artists, to be at that table, no matter how painful that is. And there has to be a level of persistence to be able to transform these communities in things where everybody gets to play, right? But I am telling you, one way or another, based on things I've seen all over the country, from Los Angeles to Texas to here to there, Canada even, you know, I did some work for Art Space Toronto in Windsor, Canada, across the river from Detroit. You think Detroit got hit bad by that? You should see what happened to Windsor. The entire downtown was empty because they had a lot of spin-off business and they employed. There was a lot of traffic on that bridge going back and forth. One of my favorite works of art I've ever experienced in my life was a 24-year-old kid that built a giant, giant sign. People in Windsor were used to looking at the skyline of Detroit. So on the Windsor side, he made giant letters that said, "We miss you." That you could see from the Detroit side of the river, right? Well, guess what? This move is happening all over the country in different parts of the world. Spaces like I've listed here are a critical component to this. Places where people can gather, can express themselves, and build and strengthen community. Taking ownership of these spaces. Now, you know, there's the top-down way we think, right? And there are certainly resources that you need to access from government and from the feds or whoever, although the feds are going to dry all that up, so get ready, right? But I think, but that doesn't mean we can't do things, right? That doesn't mean we can't get projects done. But I think this master planning and this top-down kind of way of thinking, there's a value in visioning. That's undeniable. It's great to have a carrot out front of you. But don't compromise that carrot then. Then make sure everybody's included in that conversation and in that narrative, right? So don't compromise that vision. Is it reachable tomorrow? Obviously not, okay? But you cannot underestimate or undervalue one project at a time. You begin, and what feels like sort of isolated projects slowly becomes a network of projects. And suddenly what you have is a Venn diagram instead of isolated communities and circles. And there's overlap, and some people are going to each other's events, and you're building community in that process. You know what? It's happening here. It's hard sometimes. And, you know, you have a rail. There are people spending hundreds of millions of dollars to put light rail systems in their communities. Now, there may have been advantages and disadvantages to this at one point or another. I heard some history today that was confusing to me. But about the light rail, you know?
Really?
The Lexington Market. There's going to be a major investment made in the Lexington Market. How is that investment being made? Who's included? Do local businesses get to be participate in this change, right? You will lose the texture and the feel of this community if you don't figure out how to do that. If you have 15 chain stores in that market, who cares? Where's the uniqueness and where's the identity, the unique identity in that, right? You can go, I mean, I don't need to go to a Starbucks to know what a Starbucks is like. There's nothing unique. I don't give a shit about that, right? So I'm going to end it at that because I want to entertain questions and stuff. How some troubled young person ended up building doing 100,000 square feet of development in downtown Providence in a boarded up city when we had $800, or we had a $10,000 a year budget. We were living illegally in the downtown initially, and how we managed to do that. Some of it was with the help of Buddy Cianci, who spent 5 years in a gated community run by the federal government, who was a friend of mine and a former mayor. So I want to leave it at that because tomorrow we get into a lot of details, and I think it's a reasonably good story. I think you'll be fairly entertained tomorrow, hopefully. And I will do three things tomorrow. I will give you the history and the evolution because it's a good narrative of AS220, and then I will give you the various mayors who and what their contribution was to the art and culture scene in the city during this sort of 30-year and phenomenal renaissance that has occurred in Providence, Rhode Island. Providence, Rhode Island used to be referred to as the armpit of New England, by the way. It was a pass-through. Nobody wanted to stop. They used to tell the Brown and Rizzi students, don't cross the river into downtown. It's unsafe. Now Brown and Rizzi are making investments into downtown. Critical. All institutions can be of value. They got to play nice, though, right? And then what I'm going to do is give you a little cheeky little animation that sort of kind of catalyzes the way we think about how to begin to transform communities and the role that art and culture can play in that. There are certain things that I'm uncompromising about. We'll talk about that personally, that we'll talk about that later. I think mission, value, values, this idea of visioning, these are all very important concepts. And you need touch points. You need places that you can refer back to before you lose track, you know. So I'm going to leave it at that for today. And I really am excited that we're going to have some people there tomorrow. It's always good when you do a talk and there's people there. and now, if we have a few minutes, if anybody wants to ask a few questions, is that all right?
Of course, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can
I have a first question?
Yes.
Oh, where is the talk tomorrow and how do you get in?
It's at 520 Park, which is like the lobby zone of like the 520 Park. If you go into it, it's the left.
It's not Mount Vernon Market.
No, it's not Mount Vernon Market.
It's the apartment building. It's the apartment building with all the modern furniture that looks like it's in layers.
It's in there.
Yes.
If you go in there, and it's to the left. There'll be signs and stuff, so 520 Park. And it's free.
Looks pretty chic. I'm going to wear my dress shoes tomorrow.
Oh, okay.
So what time is it?
It's free, and it's at 10 a.m., and that's specifically sponsored by Bromo Arts District. That one's exclusively sponsored by Bromo Arts District.
So does anybody have any other questions now?
I have a question.
Please.
I noticed that.
You were paying attention, I noticed.
There's a demographic in this room.
Yeah.
And most of it's white. Like very
white. I noticed.
Like there's three, maybe four.
Yeah. And then some of us can't figure out who the hell we are.
So we sit here in the west side. That's about Providence, Rhode Island.
Yep.
I don't know nothing about it.
Yeah.
I've been there. It was pretty
cool. Yeah. It's about over 50% Latino, 70% of public school population.
Are, you know, it's like, yeah, a network, right? Where is the African-American community in the process? How do we get that to be a part of the process? Because it's not Baltimore until it is.
Yeah.
And
yeah. I feel like I was referencing that idea in a number of ways without speaking specifically to black or to white.
Take it back. The one on the corner is a complete happening African American.
Yeah. And I think I mentioned them in my list of things. I can't agree with you more. I mean, how do we do those things? You got to get your hands dirty. You got to put yourself at risk. You got to go into communities that you feel uncomfortable, just like those communities have experienced traditionally in white culture, dominant culture, right? So I think that there are strategies. I think that there are ways, but people have to humble themselves. And they have to get to know who that community is, who are the leaders. You've got to build those relationships. It's hard work. Let's not bullshit ourselves about any of this. Right?
So who's doing the work?
Who's doing the work? Well, in many communities, you have institutions that do the work, right? You have CDCs, you have organizations. But I also think, you know, I remember in the 60s, after Martin Luther got shot, the Reverend Abernathy toured a lot of the colleges around the country because he wanted to give people some direction, right? And I was witness to that, one of his lectures. And he talked about, he says, I know where millions of people every single week meet at church. Now, that doesn't have the same power base that it once had. In certain areas, in certain places it does. You got to go to people. Now, who's going to do that work? It has to be a collaboration, a partnership. I can't tell you, identify who specifically that is. But you have a lot of organizations that by mission are supposed to be doing that work. If they're not, they should be held accountable. Right? But you've got to go into the communities. You've got to find the leaders in those communities. And it's messy work sometimes because you feel awkward, uncomfortable. You're likely to say some stupid things. Right? And you have to suffer through that. Right? If you really want to build trust,
Yeah, no question about it.
Right? If you really want to build trust, right? We have a profound, and Rick, I mean, the diversity at ASU20 right now, the amount of programming and stuff that from every community in Providence is remarkable. It took 30 years to get there. And I had to go to a lot of events and neighborhoods and communities and stuff like that just for people to believe me. That when I say this place is open to you and you can use it and this is how you use it, it's not enough. We're an unjuried, uncensored environment. Anybody and everybody gets to perform and participate in ASU20 if they choose to, with their original material or material that's in the public domain. I thought just saying that was enough. I got it covered. But the perception was, because of me and some of the original founders of the organization, that was a white hipster place. Right? Well, I'm responsible for that perception. In the past, I could get all righteous about it and say I'm making a place where anybody can hang out, or I can decide I want to make change in the community. And there's a difference, you know? So we had to come up with ways and thinking, and of course, it has to come from it's got to be represented the board, it's got to be represented the people who participate, it's got to be represented the audience, it's got to be represented in the youth that participate. We have a youth program, and this was one of my strategies for diversifying AS220. Now, you'll see in our mission statement where we talk about our facilities are particularly there for those who do not have access to these kinds of resources. Well, I was invited into the juvenile prison. I said, we got a whole, they're all fenced in. These are young people all over the place that are over representative of minority communities. Minority, hate that term. I ain't going with it, but for the sake of conversation, right? I said, we need to work here and get these kids to come out with us. You want to diversify our organization? Because one of the things I learned very early on is that when I hand a microphone to a kid, he sees a microphone first and the color of my skin second. That's called opportunity, right? And that's what we need to be offering people, is opportunity. Race shit goes away real quick when you start providing real opportunity. And that can take a lot of different shapes, right? For us, art and culture is a really powerful, powerful tool because personal identity and expression. When we went into the prison, they were telling those kids, you need to be fixed. We went in there and said, you have a story that needs to be heard. That's a very different approach. We're validating their life experience. We're not validating it. We're giving them opportunity to present themselves. That's another word that I have problems with. Okay? Who the fuck am I to validate anybody? right? So that was our strategy. We've won national awards. Michelle Obama gave an award to one of our kids. I mean, you know, all of this kind of stuff would work. And you know what the pathetic part of it is? We struggle to fund the program. And it's lean and mean. And we serve 500 kids. And if you have any relationship with the Department of Children and Families, or we work in the prison. So we create an appetite, we build relationships in the prison, the juvenile prison, so that kids may likely, hopefully, come see us before they hit the block. Because we know as soon as they hit the block, it's done. Right? So if we can get them to knock on our door before they knock on their buddy's door, we stand a chance. Right? And we've had remarkable success. Kids getting four-year scholarships to RISD and this and that and all this kind of stuff. And I don't have the stats, but that's up to my organization. So I don't know. Is that... I can't give an easy answer to this, you know.
I'm not going to presume to speak for the black community.
Yeah.
But it's a issue of priorities, too.
That's right.
And it's an issue of what do you focus on in community development? You know, when housing is more important than an art gallery, and when the arts are a luxury and somewhat of a privilege, when art has been taken out of the schools and it doesn't reflect the true genius within the black community, because there's too many other priorities, survival being one of them. But there's no lack of talent and no lack of artistic expression. I mean, it's typically been focused on music more than anything else, but the fact is that it's a matter of how it's nurtured and how it's supported and how it's given access to patronage and how it is given some value and promoted. That's the problem.
Yep. You're saying it, so there's really not much for me to respond to. But I'll tell you, I was privileged to work on a charrette a few days in Soulsville, Memphis, Tennessee. Soulsville, Memphis, Tennessee is a community of, I don't know, maybe 7,000 to 10,000 residents, and the Stax recording studio was there, and is pretty substantiated that it was the birth of soul in America, right, through that studio. And it was a very vibrant community. It's about 98% Afro-American. Those people today can't walk to a bottle of milk.
True.
Right? And yet, do you realize, they had a sign. One of the things I recommended to them, I say that humbly, okay? But they were very proud of a mural they painted entering into Soulsville that says, "We love Soulsville." And when we went in and started investigating Soulsville, the history and everything else, my pushback was, that's nice. Now you got to tell them why. They had two charter schools in Soulsville, Memphis, Tennessee, the poorest community in all of Memphis, that were the highest performing high schools, one in the city and one in the state of Tennessee. Nobody knows that story. No one would expect that to be true, right? They had a police precinct in Soulsville that went out of business because it wasn't